Well, good evening, everybody. I'll get started. Tonight, we will be finishing up Chapter 15 and going into Chapter 16. Going into Chapter 16, which is the respiratory section of your textbook. Before we start that, though, I'm not sure if everybody had a chance. I was just trying something new, and I know you didn't get yours, but in the email, I had sent a sample report, and I thought that went over some of the concepts that we talked about in the integumentary system. So just to kind of give you some hands-on examples, I thought we'd start by going over that this evening, and then... You couldn't. Okay. All right. That's fine. So we'll start by going over that report. Then we'll finish up Chapter 15 of the musculoskeletal system before we go into respiratory. My understanding at the conclusion of last class is there was a chapter. Whoops. I thought I had that. Excuse me. Hello? Absolutely. Absolutely.
I told her I don't look at my email because I can't access it at work, and at home my kids always on the computer, so it's like...
Well, anytime we get something, I usually I text you and let you know that
emails from her, I don't have any.
Oh, you don't have any.
And
okay.
It's because, one, I don't think I got, but this time I didn't look yet.
Okay. So the Spruce Mountain location is still having trouble, but we'll get that.
Time with that one.
Okay. All right. So we'll start by going over the report. Again, this is, I went on to a transcription site like I shared at the last class. I found them very beneficial as I was starting out to just get acclimated to what documentation would look like. And this is a pretty standard report for what you would see. So there were a couple of concepts that came up in here that I wanted to address. I still have it on my phone. That's why my phone is out. I'm not texting, but just so you know. So the preoperative diagnoses, they didn't do pre-op, post-op. That's fine. It's consistent throughout. But there's an enlarging nevus of the left upper cheek, and then an enlarging nevus that is 0.5 to 1 centimeter on the left lower cheek. And then an enlarging superficial nevus that is 0.5 to 1 centimeter of the nasal ala. So there's all kinds of great terms there that actually help segue into this one as well. So nevus is a mole. It's just it's a type of mole. There is, if you follow the process in ICD-10 and look
That's
up...
That's where I was having trouble because I was looking up lesion, I was looking up nevus, and I had the same problem because
and
they
nevus
had
didn't,
in
didn't
nevus.
Give you one? No?
Nevus,
okay.
I couldn't find nevus, and that was the problem.
Okay, so let's take a look at that because that would be the key term.
Right, that and that's what it, that was the first term I looked for was nevus because that was the primary term. And then I started looking for other stuff because I couldn't find it.
Okay.
And I had, there was one of the questions, I think it was in the workbook, that also had the word nevus, and I couldn't find it. I found it in a bizarre roundabout way.
Okay.
So N-E-R-N-E,
should be
U-N-E,
N-V,
U-N-E, N-E-V-O, nevocarcinoma. That's what I kept finding was nevocarcinoma. And then it goes to newborn.
That is odd.
Okay. That's why I was very confused.
Is the report that you're talking about that you were working on in a workbook?
There was a strawberry Nevis, and I can't remember if it was in the workbook or if it was at the end of a chapter thing.
I don't remember.
And I couldn't find that one either.
Okay, this is not what I was expecting to. All right, let me.
So then I decided, I'll look up neoplasm.
Then this is different than the one I have, too.
In the report itself, as you read the report, it was saying, it had a neoplasm.
I like that book better.
Yeah.
I do.
So it's in the neoplasm table.
It is, yes.
But
and
it's not separate.
It's actually specific to a benign neoplasm.
So it breaks down.
There they are. All right.
Because I was looking, I was like, well, is it uncertain behavior? Because there was no path lab. So are we supposed to assume?
All right. So let me share. Marty, can you hear me and see me? Nope, not yet. Okay. So let me share what the problem is or what you should be seeing in your ICD-10 book because
I don't even have the same one you do. What do you have?
They're absolutely right. Try
so
nevi,
because
the plural of nevus is nevi.
N-E-V-I. The C goes N-E-U to N-E-V-O. So there is not
no,
an
okay.
N.
How come yours is different than mine, even? The color.
This is for...
No, it should be...
Oh, this is for hospital.
Okay.
So, just so you know, I'm not making it up, and I don't know why the books are different. But there's it's too close. There's an entry in here.
That's Nevis.
Right there. Okay.
So I looked under, I tried looking it up under other things. So I looked up skin. Like I was trying to backtrack to figure out how they were finding it.
Yeah, because that would.
I don't know if that's a typo or.
Well, I don't, they should be identical. And that's, we'll look into that. We'll look into why.
I have Nevis too, look.
You have it in
you
which one?
You have it in
but
yours.
But you don't have, do you all right.
What is yours again?
Mine is the.
That's that one like the Hick Picks book we got.
Chemical modification.
Finding it.
Okay. I'm not sure why the books are different because the one I have is actually different and I have my software tool. They all had that. I'm not sure why this
skin see also condition
isn't.
So skin see also condition. So when you go to condition, it's going to tell you disease. I already know this because I do this all the time. Okay, so complication, compression, concussion.
What happened to me with the other book, that's why I was like
conditions see disease,
but I'm still not sure that in going
all right so here's disease,
but unless you knew that that nevus was a type of neoplasm, I'm thinking
well,
that
doesn't it say in the operative report that it like when they're discussing within the report itself, wasn't it saying neoplasm?
He did call it a neoplasm, but and that's one of the points that I wanted to make was he said it's a skin shave excision of the right nasal a la skin neoplasm.
Right.
And the a la is this outer portion of your nair. Okay. So on your nose, when we get into respiratory, there'll be some reference to that. And it's this part on the outside of your nair, on the nose. So that's where that's located. And they're saying that's a skin neoplasm. But again, we need to know whether it was unspecified or unknown or benign or
exactly.
Malignant or secondary. We'd need to know that condition.
It goes from mold to MOLI, so I can't even look it up that way.
Hmm. All right, we'll get to the bottom of that, but for this, just bear with me for now, and that's unfortunate because I'm not sure you wouldn't get there. on this particular report, and this wasn't
Neo Plus. If I go to the Neo Plus and table, I still wouldn't get the right answer.
Right.
So the best way to do, for me to do this with regard to anything that has Nevis, would be to go online and do like an ICD 10
search.
Nevis.
Yes.
Okay.
But the unfortunate part is without that this confirmation, you wouldn't have known that you needed to do that.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
So when we get in here, unless it specifies these are benign neoplastic conditions, okay? So when we look this up and there's multiple entries, there's actually three columns of entries under Nevis. And one of the, so the first one, if I looked at skin, which is what this is, of the external cheek, it refers us to D22.39. So following that, and I'm doing the ICD-10 first because especially with the assignment of skin excision categories, we need to know what we're dealing with, whether it's a benign or a malignant or some other kind of condition. So I'm starting here and determining, having the ICD-10 assignment drive my CPT selection. So when I get to this section, this reference, D22.39, right here, it's a melanchonic melocytic nevi of other and unspecified parts of face. Because if you look down through the list under D22.1 in the tabular section of the book, and I don't know if it will,
benign for the ala, the external nose, neoplasm nose, for benign is D23.39. So that's close.
That is close. Okay.
That's for the bottom one, though. It's not for the other two.
But do you have, because this one refers us to still, what does your tabular look like? If you go to D22.39, what does that look like?
D22.39. Benign neoplasm of connective and other soft tissue unspecified.
Okay.
D22.39,
right here.
Melanocytic nevi of other parts of face.
Okay, so we get here, but we can't get here through the index.
Right.
Okay. So this card is the same.
The tabular is the same. So the tab is the same. So D22 should be a melanocytic nevi.
Right.
Okay.
Yep. That's right. Okay. So in the index, when we look at both, I don't know why your nose takes you to another place, but both of them, meaning your nose entry, takes you to another place. The D22.39 is actually, because it's the other part of face. If you look at the beginning of that whole tabular piece, we have it specific to eyelids, we have it specific to ears, and then it becomes unspecified parts of face. So that's where we get the nose cheek ones. Okay, but the important part from this one is that we arrive at the fact that it's a benign lesion. So then, let me bring up the report again. The next part says the patient was evaluated pre-op and noted to be in stable condition. Chart and informed consent were all reviewed pre-op. All risks, benefits, and alternatives regarding the procedure have been reviewed in detail with the patient. Risks including but not limited to bleeding, infection, scarring, recurrence of lesion, need for further procedures have all been reviewed. Each of these lesions appear to be a benign nevi. Okay, so he's saying that it is. Unfortunately, that term appearing to be makes it non-definitive. So luckily, everything meshes, because otherwise we would have to go with what he says for the pre-op, because that term appearing to be would have otherwise made that
If that word wasn't there, it would have been benign.
Right. If
but
that
because that word's there, you have
we'd to. Have to question. But we have another place where he referenced it that it's okay to. So it is okay to use that at this point. However, they have been increasing in size. The lesions involving the left upper and left lower cheek appear to be deep. These required standard excision, with the smaller lesion of the right nasal ala being more superficial and amenable to a superficial shave excision. Each of these lesions was marked. The skin was cleaned with a sterile alcohol swab. Anesthetic was infiltrated. Sterile prep and drape were then performed. So far we have nothing to code. But I did want to mention, too, that if we looked at the title of the procedures, biopsy of the left upper cheek skin neoplasm, 0.5 to 1 centimeter with a two-layer closure, and biopsy of the left lower cheek skin neoplasm, 0.5 to 1 with a two-layer plastic closure. So in each of those, they use the term biopsy, but as I probably discussed to death last time, we have to look and see, is he leaving part of that neoplasm or that lesion behind, or is he taking the whole thing? Okay. So, began first excision of the left upper cheek skin lesion. This was excised with a 15 blade full thickness once it was removed in its entirety. So we've then switched from a biopsy to a true excision. We're dealing with benign, and this is the first one. Undermining was performed. Okay, undermining, so those, and he referenced in here that there were different layers of tissue that he was addressing. Undermining, he's, before he closes the skin, he's closing some of those deeper layers. So we have a two-layer closure or an intermediate closure. And remember, as we talked about before in integumentary, if it's more than simple, it can be separately reported. Okay, so we have the first lesion is an excision, and that's CPT 11441.
Hi, 11446.
Okay, let's see.
So, we look it up under.
We go to the back. Sorry, I'm skipping steps. So we go excision.
But we go here, right? To look it up first?
Okay. Yeah, she's going to the index and looking up excision.
Yeah, mine might be backwards.
Yeah, it is.
Yours is...
Oh,
CPT. Oh, yes, for the procedure. Yeah, sorry.
It's procedures in here, diagnoses are in there.
Right. So we're going to excision, and then we're going to skin. Okay, skin, lesion, benign.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have all kinds of different codes to look at. Yeah. So, but the first one in the series, so we can look up that family, is 11400. To the front. 11400. So remember, these are broken down by anatomic location, and then within each grouping, they're defined by the size. We have two sizes, 0.5 centimeters and 1 centimeter. We can take the biggest dimension of that. We can't, it's, okay.
I thought that when it said that it was 0.5 by 1, I thought it was like the picture here, 0.5 by 1.
It can be, but we're dealing with a diameter or one measurement and not an area where we use both measurements.
Okay.
So we're only going to take the biggest of those two measurements.
Okay.
Right? Remember, it's on the cheek, right. So we have to go to the face. So the first group is trunk, arms, or legs.
All right.
Okay. So we're not, we have to skip down through those 11400s.
Okay.
The next time that we have a change is 11420. We're getting closer. Now it's scalp, neck, genitalia. So the scalp is closer, but we're still, the scalp would be where included in the hairline parts. All right. So we'll skip down again. And then it's face, ears, eyelids, nose, lips, mucous membrane, and that's the end of the list. So those three groupings. So we're in here, and we're doing that. We determined that it was either 0.5 or 1. We're going to give him the credit for the largest dimension. So it would be 0.6 centimeters to 1.0 centimeters or 11441 for the upper cheek.
We and are, you have to do, and I know what I did wrong, because what I did was I was looking at this, so I was doing that.
Giving him margins.
Addition, yeah, giving him margin. So I was giving him that, and whatever that total was, so one, so it was like point, how would they did the 0.5 and 0.5, and then it's the one. So I was like, oh, okay. So I did that, and then I added these two together.
Gotcha.
Because they were both on the same part of the body. So I figured you added the total area of the cheek because it's the same. You
same
see what I'm saying?
I do.
And then doing, then I did the right nasal ala as its own coat.
Okay. And we will, okay. So I'm glad that we are clarifying that.
Okay.
And I'm glad that, because these are common things that are tricky with these, and that's why it seems very, you know.
Okay, thank you so much.
I wasn't sure where.
Oh, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, hi.
All right, touchdown. All right.
I just got, was that 114? I got 11442, but you're saying it's 11441?
It's 11441.
It is.
Like, it
is. It's not 2 centimeter incision?
It's not.
Alicia, it's not.
Not for the excision part,
okay.
Because
yeah,
if we'll keep reading, but he's taking the second one out through a separate incision because he was on the upper cheek and he was on the lower cheek. And then he mentions closing that before he addresses that lower lesion.
Okay.
Okay. Welcome, Marty. I'm so glad that worked. All right. So the next part of this, these are my friends. I have these all the time, or my notebook. If I have a really complex case that I know I might be questioned on later on, I keep all of my notes in a notebook so that I can refer back, and it's like, I remember that case, and this was how I got to where I was. If it's something like this, where, you know, there's more to it than what I'm going to get, I'll just use a sticky note, and when I'm done, I toss it, okay? See? Right here is what I had. So the first one, like I said, 11441, we have that. Now we have to deal with the closure. Remember, I just said that he did some undermining, so we're looking at intermediate. We can separately report that, okay? But in him closing that and then proceeding to talk about another excision, we're going to be giving him credit for 2 different excision codes. If he had done, you know, all of them in one and there was one incision, I'd ask him to clarify his documentation in the real world, but an assumption would be if he's only making one excision that he included both in there. Okay? So then that addition piece that you're, I can understand that, but that's not what he's talking about here. Okay? So the lesion of the lower cheek was removed in a similar manner. It's not beautiful, but that's, they're looking for shortcuts too, okay? They don't want to be at the dictaphone all night. So the lesion of the lower cheek was removed in a similar manner, completely separate from the upper. Also excised with a 15 blade and a two-layer, and a two-layer plastic closure was done, okay? So we're dealing with a repeat of what we had before. So it's another instance of 11441. Okay?
Yeah.
But now we have a second closure, and it's with those closures that you're adding.
Okay.
Okay? He doesn't get...
Because he's not using the same closures?
He's using the same type of closures, but when we look at the guidelines in there, everything of the same region is being, so if it's an intermediate closure and it's in the same anatomic location, like we're not dealing with the face and the arm, or let's say, we're going to group all of those together to report with one code, the largest code we can. All right?
Okay.
So in adding 1 centimeter and 1 centimeter, then we have 2 centimeters. And if we come over to our intermediate repair codes on page, starting on page 80 and going to 81.
So it'd be repair intermediate.
Right. We're looking at intermediate repair because, again, it was 2 layers.
Is this one of the examples from our book or just one you pulled up?
No, this is the one that she emailed us.
I just pulled it up, but these are the, one is that we're going to see repeatedly.
More complex than the reports that are in our workbook.
Oh, is that?
It just, they're a little bit more complex because of the detailing, that the wording of that is more real than the wording.
Okay.
And it, that's simple. That's
all right. So maybe I went to
simple intermediate.
Okay. So maybe I went a little too far for the first one.
No, that's okay.
So the first group. When we're looking for the intermediate, again, it's grouped by location. It's not a mirror image of what we had with our lesion excisions, because now the first one is scalp, axilla, trunk, and extremities. And if you remember back to when we were looking at lesion excisions, it was basically trunk and extremities were one, and then we had the scalp, genitalia, hands, feet, and another. So it's not, we're not necessarily dealing with the same section, so make sure you're reading those to see what's inclusive for the anatomy. The next grouping down that starts with 12041 is neck, hands, feet, and external genitalia. And then we have the last one, we're still not there, is face, eyes, earlids, nose, lips, and mucous membranes, okay? So let's say, following along with that same concept, both of these were of the face. Let's say that we had, one was on the face and one was on an ear. Because they still fit in that same category, we're still adding them together, okay? And reporting them under that same code. In here, because we have, it starts at 2.5 centimeters or less, and I want to make sure I have this right, but typically if it's less than 2.5, you go to simple. I'll have to look that up. I thought that was the rule.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it's or less. Never mind. It's in complex where it starts at 1. If it's lower than 1, then it goes to simple or intermediate. Sorry about that. Okay. So 12051 fits that dimension for us. Wounds of the face, 2 centimeters. So we'd report that.
Okay. So we would be reporting 11441 twice?
Twice.
So there would be 11441 times 2?
Yes.
Okay.
And 12055 for the closure for both of those. And
No, 12051.
Oh, what did I say?
2.5 or less for the those two.
Yes, what you said. One, I'm looking at 12051. Whatever I said was incorrect. What I'm looking at is right. 12051 is the right one.
Pina?
Yes.
That doesn't need modifier 59. Because I Googled that and they said some carriers like to have modifier 59 even on that.
They might. They might. In the NCCI edits, and I know we've talked about that before, that's basically a Medicare tool. It doesn't it doesn't come up as requiring one for that. Just, spoiler alert, there is one for the nose code that we're going to come up with. Would require a 59. If you put it on there without having that tool, I think that's a cautious approach, and that's not a bad approach to have for as far as that goes.
So if we did that, so it would just be on the 12051 that we put that modifier?
Well, actually, for this purpose, that one is the higher valued code, and we wouldn't put one on there. So that's okay. It would actually be on, if you put one, the 12051 would be listed first, then the 11441s would be.
So the repair, and then the excisions less, and that's where you put the 59 on the last value.
Right.
So it would be 11441-59 times 2.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. But in checking edits, it's really a 51 that we use, but that's okay.
Okay.
I won't be as concerned about modifiers on this part, but that's a good point, Marty. Some payers will probably, because even though the rules are out there, insurance companies make up their own. So there might be some payers that would require that as a point of denial. I don't mean to always be anti-insurance, but
no,
it's the way it works.
It is what it is.
That's the way the industry works. So we might as well be clear about the game.
What I've seen in the office is it seems like the exact same insurance, and you're billing pretty much the exact same procedure, and depending on what that patient's policy is, you could get that one kicked back, and it'll be like, oh, you didn't put this modifier. It's like, well, I didn't put it on the other 20 that was sent. Why would I put it on this one? Well, because this patient's plan is X, blah, blah, blah.
Yes.
All right, fine, here, we'll change it. Okay, now you're going to pay
us. Exactly, yeah. And that's basically what we do. We do correct coding first, and then unless we know the payer guideline, usually we end up modifying on denial. Okay. So. Okay, so dealing with the nasal ala nevus, it was superficially shaved. Okay, so I'm thinking they've got the razor blade out and they're going to shave this. So I'm looking to those shave codes. However, they throw a curve in here and they say they used radio frequency. Okay, so now it becomes a destruction instead of a shave. All right, he's using a different tool.
Oh.
So it's not, it then becomes destruction. So if we look at those destruction codes, which are on 17110, maybe this was too much. It's destruction using laser surgery, electrocautery, cryosurgery, chemosurgery, or surgical curettment. Okay. That's where we're looking at, because it's more than just here's the razor blade,
cut it off.
So we're looking at the destruction codes, and again, this is one of the reasons why I gave you that tip. I don't always keep my diagnosis. If I kept reading down through and at the very last statement he said okay and it turned out to be malignant, the whole thing would be changed, but that's not what happened. So, but I do know that his, from determining my ICD-10 first, that I'm dealing with a benign neoplasm. So again, making sure that we're clear on what differentiates each code section from each one. The first one's a pre-malignant. Okay. Well, is
benign.
That
benign? It says benign or pre-malignant.
Right, benign or pre-malignant. Pre-malignant is not this, is not synonymous with benign. Okay. So we're looking down through the next one, and again, there, it's first lesion and then add-on codes for subsequent lesions. And it's also, okay, and then the next one is if it's in excess of 14, 15 or more. Then we come down, and the next one is cutaneous vascular proliferative lesions. We're not dealing with anything vascular in nature either. He didn't mention anything about vascular being in there. So we're not looking at that section. The next one down is destruction of benign lesions other than skin tags. So that fits what our diagnosis is. Okay? Do you see how I'm pairing those up? The diagnosis is driving the CPT.
Uh-huh.
They're both benign. So I'm selecting a benign CPT code. And this one changes a little bit. It's up to 14 lesions, whereas the first one was first lesion and then there were add-on codes. This is just up to 14 lesions or more than 15.
So this would be 17110.
Correct.
Okay.
17110. Okay. And like I said, you know.
So what was the wording in the report for the
radio?
Radio frequency. Now, radio frequency, what is that classified as? Is that like electrosurgery?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Radio frequency would
be... Cryosurgery, freezing. Because I didn't know if it was electrosurgery or laser.
Yeah.
Laser is...
It's a really
burning light.
Okay. Yeah, it's more burning. So the radio frequency is taking electronic pulse waves to remove that. Okay?
Okay.
All right.
You really can't look up radio frequency and it takes you anywhere. You have to know pretty much what it is, don't you?
You'd have to know that you were dealing with a destruction. I mean, when you go to shave, let me see if we can get there. I'm sorry. But this is good. This helps me. I've got a backup. And that's good. I know how to... Okay, shaving of a skin lesion takes us to 11300 because that's where I thought I needed to be before.
Yeah.
So if I go to 11300... I thought it sent me to.
It doesn't send me there.
Sorry, Marty. You're right. Unless you knew the term that it was, the difference was it was a destruction. I see that. You wouldn't necessarily get back to that code.
Yeah, a lot of the examples in the workbook. You can pretty much get to your CPT codes and your ICD-10 from the pre-op diagnosis, post-op diagnosis, and procedure.
Okay.
You're getting it from there. So this was actually a good example because it forced us to actually read the report.
Yeah.
But there were some things just because we didn't know exactly. Like now we know what to be looking for.
Right.
It helps us.
And I guess my thing, I write all over my books. It doesn't matter what book it is. If it's a coding book and it's mine, it's getting marked up. So every single one of them, and I have them back 5 years. So as codes change, and it's like, I remember I had a case where I dealt with this before, and it will be like, okay, was it 2012 or 2013, I'll go back and I'll look because I'll have notes in there. So I get, feel free to do the same, especially as you're prepping for your exam. mark this thing up. Don't be afraid to mark this thing up to give yourself reference points to other things.
Okay.
So I might write on page 74.
Yeah.
You know, write yourself a note to consider destruction codes that are on page... Where were they? 117 on page 91. Okay, so maybe just put a note to yourself to question, do I have to see page 71?
Okay.
Okay.
Now that does need a 59 modifier on that, right?
That one does. Yes.
Yeah.
It sure does, because especially when you get into multiples and things like that, the concept would be that it would be plausible for a provider to shave first and then excise that site after. Whatever the conclusive or definitive would be what he reported. So if he shaved and then at that same site excised, we couldn't report both. Providers would want to account for that extra time that they took on that, but it wouldn't be permissible. So we're letting the insurance company know that we know that typically these could be done simultaneous, you know, in sequence, but we really have confirmed that they're separate. It's separate lesions and separate procedures that we're dealing with. Okay? I hope that helped. And if you don't mind, I picked that one because I zeroed in on the fact that he said biopsy, and it wasn't a biopsy, it was an excision. I hope that was beneficial to everybody. And if you don't mind,
so
I'll
what is
probably try.
The diagnosis is the same for all three?
Yes. It
okay.
ends up being the same for all three, D22.39.
So that would be the only code. So when you're coding, you have your CPTs, you have the, so you do 12051, then 11441, whether you add the modifier or not, times two.
Correct.
And then 171.10.59.
Yeah.
And then this would go under the diagnosis, the only diagnosis.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. Yep. All right. Any questions on that? Like I said, I hope that was helpful.
So when you were talking about the note to write, you said you want us to...
I would suggest, because there's no way to get from the back. And I'm not saying that you normally would need
right.
that, but because we couldn't find a path to get to that destruction code for what we needed,
yeah.
I would just put next to those shave codes, do I need to see, like my terminology that makes sense to me, is I'd put a question mark and say, see destruction, so that it will prompt me to look
at the page number.
I had it on page...
I just don't think I have the right page number.
91?
Okay, that's
right. Yeah, 91.
Yes, 91. Thank you.
So for the Nevis, should I do the same thing?
Yeah, and I'm going to get to the bottom of that.
Because that can't be the only place.
Marty, which ICD-10 book do you have? You have the same book?
Yeah.
2017.
Did you find Nevis in your
index
when you were looking it up?
Well, it took me to D23.39 when I looked it up. That's why I was looking back here. But I
did
see.
Did you
in the index?
It up
I don't.
The neoplasm table. Or did you look it up? You looked it up in the neoplasm table.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because you. In my copy, there's actually an entry for Nevis under the index. So, again, I think if we're marking them up, we might as well mark them up good. And I think I would put that in your index.
Put Nevis.
See. That D22.
Okay.
And I just put CD22 because you might not know
which one
you need.
Okay.
But it does take you to that series.
Okay. And there wouldn't be any other... I mean, that deals with Nevis on all parts of
the
body,
correct?
Well,
those are skin.
skin.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But skin, it would cover just about anywhere on the body.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, okay, so that you wouldn't have gone to the neoplasm on that one. The neoplasm table?
I wouldn't have gone there directly.
Okay.
Because not knowing. I mean, I happen to know that it's a mole, and moles are benign neoplasms. But in following the process and starting in the index, I looked up the term nevus first.
Okay.
And then went to the subterm skin, and then went to the subterm cheek and nose. And it sent me to the benign neoplasm codes. But, because of that deviation in whether it's a 2-2 or a 2-3.
Yeah.
That's where I'm not sure why that is occurring.
Yeah, because when you look at, I wish I knew which one it was in the workbook that had it, because where the Q82.5, strawberry nevocarcinoma.
Yeah.
But the one that was in the workbook was a benign nevus, strawberry nevus.
Yeah.
And I can't remember what it brought me to. I'll see if I can.
Okay. So if I looked...
If I look
at this in my index, using her example that you had in your assignments for strawberry nevus, there's a specific entry for that, and it takes us right to Q82.5. I thank you for bearing with me on that, and I hope you found that helpful. I'll try to find others that correspond to what we're doing. Just to some of those key points. Again, I was still hooked on that biopsy versus excision. Okay, so we left off last week in Chapter 15 of the Musculoskeletal System on page 418. And the spinal instrumentation and fixation codes. And these are pretty intense procedures. I won't be giving you one of these to look at. Oftentimes, most of the spinal instrumentation, we're working in musculoskeletal, but we could also be working in the nervous system. Okay, so and if you look at the parenthetical notes on some of these, there are actually times when it will refer you back to the 60,000 section. Now, one of the other things that I wanted to make sure that we, before we get in there, on page 117, I almost forgot to mention. So rib fractures on page 117, they didn't mention them here. These are one of these where there's been a lot of changes. For a while, we didn't have an external rib fixation code. They gave us one for a few years, and now they've deleted it again. So I guess there's just not a lot of call for external instrumentation.
They don't usually do anything for rib fractures, do they, per se?
Not usually. They might have to...
If it's, going to puncture your lung or something, they would have
to. Right, if it's floating, they might. So, basically, it's just those open codes that are there. And the only reason I'm pointing it out is because if it's external, that's not a misprint. You end up... they actually want you to report an unlisted code. Okay, now over to spines. So one of the there's several points on there that I want to make. One is we could be looking in musculoskeletal. We could also be looking back in the nervous system codes. They usually go hand in hand. In your CPT book, they're also saying on page 117, there's some green in there. But one of the things that I wanted to bring up is this is often a situation where co-surgery and modifier 62 is often used. Because we normally do have an orthopedic surgeon and a neurosurgeon that are working in conjunction. We might also have a general surgeon because often what happens is somebody will come in and do the approach, get down through all the muscle and vessels for the orthopedic surgeon, so they're just dealing with the spine where it's so tedious. And that would also cause, if they're applying or supplying the approach, and then often they'll come back in and close after the spine procedure is done for the spinal surgeon, that constitutes modifier 62 or that co-surgeon. Okay, so don't be surprised if you see that often. There were quite a few changes in here this year. There's what's called a cage that they put in, and there were quite a few changes to that. Okay, sorry, I'm flipping back and forth, but I don't want to miss anything important, so I'm going sequentially between the CPT and your textbook. Back in your textbook on 418, they're talking about that there's arthrodesis of different cervical areas. Arthrodesis is just another term for fusion. And again, the providers will use those synonymously. So basically, let's say that you have some kind of disc degeneration, and they're either manipulating, changing, heaven forbid, removing one of your vertebrae, and they have to make sure that there's still, we can't have empty space in there. So what they do is they fuse the remaining structures together using either bone from other material, as long as there's no disease process in the bone that they're removing, they might use some of that. They do what they call morselize it. I just like that term. But they'll chunk it up and then they'll pack it back in to some of these devices. It's called a cage. And well, it was called a cage, and that's what they changed this year. But they'll fill that in, and then they'll use instrumentation. And what happens over time is the body regenerates itself. It grows new bone with those bone pieces that they put in there. That's what arthrodesis is this fusion. So they break it up into different areas, starting with the cervical area. Now, what's important to note with the cervical area is there's the occiput to C2. You can't really get to the occiput. It's covered by your skull. All right? So when they're talking about the occiput to C2, cervical vertebrae 2 to the occiput is one section, then C1, C2, and then below the C2 segment. And then we go into the thoracic and the lumbar and the sacrum. Okay?
Can you do like reconstruction surgery? Like, for instance, I don't know if you would know, but like, I know they had to reconstruct my father's chest. What do you think, what are the possibilities that they use to reconstruct it?
Yeah, they could.
Bone from other places or what?
They could use bone from other places. There's, just like when we talked about, allograft, just like when we talked about skin grafts, they have lab type stuff that they make in a lab.
What do you call that?
Or they
it's
could,
not naturally from someone's body. It's synthetic?
Yeah, synthetic. Exactly.
I was just curious what they use.
Yep,
I'm sure
they
my
could.
Father's wife will blah, 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 all the details.
I'm sure, yeah.
If she ever talks to me again.
So the C1 is often referred to as the atlas, and the C2 is often referred to as the axis. And I'm just bringing this up because there are some points. My example is 22548 in your CPT manual. They use those terminology. Okay? They don't use, you can garner or you can put your detective hat on and determine that they're talking about the upper levels of the cervical vertebrae, but if we have that already determined, that axis and atlas, if we've got that tucked away, filed away in your brain there, that will help you out. Okay. So other parts of this, and you can see, it starts on page 117, and it does not stop until you get to 128. There's a lot of codes that deal with the spine, and there's a lot of add-on codes for different parts that you do. But if you ever get into that type of surgery, and I can tell you that it's only been in the last year that I've dived into that. It scared me for a long time. Now I don't care.
More experience, right?
Yeah. Now I don't care. But there's still parts that I'm not as comfortable with, and I bounce it off from a colleague. But we're looking for approach. Now the spine, think about it. It goes down the center of your body pretty much, although you feel it mostly in the posterior or your back, okay? But there are problems that can arise from an anterior approach. And this is where or through the thoracic cavity or the abdomen, let's say.
They wouldn't be able to go in through your back.
They'd have to go in through the stomach. And that's usually where this concept of co-surgery comes in, is if you have to have somebody come in and open the chest in order to get through all of those other organs to get to your spine, you wouldn't really want somebody operating on your spine after they've already done 2 hours just to get there. Okay? See how that concept is helpful? All right? So if it's an anterior approach or a posterior approach, we're looking at different sections of codes. Okay, and I'm going to leave it there because there's actually a third one. It's posterior lateral, where they come in on the flank through the rib cage.
Doesn't
but
that scare
we're not going to
you,
talk about those.
You know, when you said you don't want someone that's been already operating for 3 hours working on your spine, what does that make you think about when you think about that whole thing with my father? The guy was doing 2 surgeries same time, and it was like 8 hours.
Yeah.
Doing 2 surgeries same time. No wonder he got an infection.
Right.
They're asking for trouble when they do that.
Yeah. There's usually multiple people in there. It's true.
But I mean, isn't that scary? I mean, because they're putting so much pressure on the doctors to put out, and then they're putting out and they screw up.
Right.
It can happen. We'll say that.
Things happen, that's for sure. So in this paragraph on page 419, the arthrodesis can be performed with other surgical procedures. So I kind of foreshadowed a little bit. If you had a herniated disc and they were removing part of the disc, or a discectomy, okay? That's the official term for it, discectomy. After they were done that discectomy, they'd have to do the arthrodesis or the fusion. There's all kinds of add-on codes. If they use allograft, if they use bone from a hip to replace that, if they use some kind of synthetic device, there's all kinds of add-on codes that go with those. Okay? So, and there's also add-on codes for whether they're talking about for the range. Okay, so let's say that you were in really bad shape. Usually I see this after a trauma, and there's fractures to more than one segment. If they had to come in and either repair a section of vertebrae that was more than one, there are add-on codes for that. Now, it's also important to note whether the code is dealing with a segment or an interspace, okay? So the segment is where, and actually this picture at the bottom of 419 kind of helps us out a little bit. The segment is that actual vertebrae. The interspace is between or where the disc usually is. Okay? And just, again, just to help you out, because I have this in every book I have. If you look at page 123 of the CPT book, code 22600 starts a series for an arthrodesis, or this fusion of a posterior or posterior lateral technique. We won't get into that.
Okay.
Single level below the C2 segment. Okay. But what they're actually talking about, because we're dealing with arthrodesis, is an interspace. They're saying below the C2 segment. So I don't want you to be confused about that, because
it's not the actual vertebrae.
It's not the vertebrae. It's counted by interspace.
And so
which
code
are you looking
at? So the
22600.
So where it says below the C2 segment, so the first interspace would be the one immediately below C2.
Correct. And that's what we're dealing with, is those interspaces.
Okay.
Okay? So if they say that they repair C2 to C4, okay? C2 to C4 is 1, 2, 3 vertebrae, but there's only 2 disc spaces, okay? So that's where your counts can be off, because and where you have to know whether...
So what's a good note to put there? How would you word it?
I
know what you're saying.
I put equals interspace.
Okay.
On there, because
so
that's
count
what
by inner space.
Count by inner space,
okay.
For 22600, 22610, until you get 22612 and 22614. So it's only those four codes.
22600.
Yep. Through 22614.
22614. Count
inner space.
Interspace.
Yep.
614, you said?
Yep.
Count interspace, not vertebrae.
Right. Okay. Okay, so while you're writing, just want to bring home this coding shot that they have there on 419. When choosing codes for spine procedures, verify whether the code is describing a vertebral segment, the actual bony segment, versus an interspace, the space between two segments. If reporting a procedure performed at L4, L5, you would choose the primary code representing L4 and the add-on code representing L5. If the procedure code description was by interspace, only one code would be assigned. Okay,
so
see how that difference happens?
And that should be at the beginning of the red spine section, correct?
It should, yes. You could put that at the beginning if you wanted to write yourself a note.
Because if we're doing anything, we should be looking at the beginning of the section as well as beginning of musculoskeletal, see if there's any codes and the coding guidelines. And then we'd also look at the beginning of the spine coding guidelines, correct?
Right. Right.
Okay.
So just you know, the key points are we anterior or posterior? Once you figure out what they're doing, is it an anterior or posterior approach?
So it is
broken down into the different levels, cervical, thoracic, lumbar, sacral. And then make sure interspace versus segment.
At the beginning of the spinal section?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So is it an anterior posterior approach?
Yep.
And then to
you have to determine
section
which one
of
it is.
Right.
Section
and
of
they
spine.
Would they would tell you whether it's anterior or posterior, although if they weren't clear, usually it's in the title of the procedure, but you'd be able to tell whether they're going through the chest or whether they have the patient lying face down and they're coming through the back.
Okay, so whether it's anterior, posterior, whatever approach, the section of the spine, and then is it vertebrae or
is it segment?
Segment or interspace?
Yep.
Interspace or vertebrae?
I'm going to give you the same CPT terms. Okay, so I would say
segment, not vertebrae.
Right. Just hopefully in your you'll remember that segment equals vertebrae, but the terms that CPT uses is segment or interspace.
Okay. Gotcha.
Spinal instrumentation is used to stabilize the spinal column in some repair procedures. We talked about those a little bit. Segmental instrumentation is the attachment of a fixation device at each end of the area being repaired. Okay? So if, let's say that they were repairing, I'm going to use a big section again, but if we... Let's look at that picture on page 419. Let's say that they were adding a rod, okay, in there, and they were taking it from T8 to L2. If it was segmental, there would be a screw at T8, T9, T10, T11, all the way down to L2, okay? And they would be able to get credit for that segmental instrumentation. If it's non-segmental instrumentation, which is typically what happens, there's one at the top, there's one at the bottom, okay? The codes are differentiated by that as well.
Wouldn't it be more, I mean, whatever you call it, safer, stable, more stable? If they put more screws, why would they just put one at each end?
To minimize, if you had like a osteoporosis, you'd want to minimize putting foreign material or disrupting the bone. Okay. For example,
more risk of fracture. And all
more
that.
Risk of fracture. And oftentimes, like when they're using these, I'm thinking of scoliosis patients are usually fairly young. And as they continue to grow, they have to change these. So they don't want to have.
The rods or whatever.
Right. So you don't want to have. You want to minimize the revision surgery coming in.
An old boyfriend, he had to have a rod put in his spine. And he had to have two surgeries because the first one, they just put a pin at the top and pin at the bottom, but then once he reached, they determined he wasn't growing anymore, then they made it more permanent.
Right.
And at that point, he set off even more metal detectors than he did before.
I bet.
He has a special note in like 50 different languages, like every time he has to go through security. No, I'm not a terrorist. I may look like one, but I'm not.
Oh, that's great. So that's the, I've spent years, we could spend days going over spines, but those are the key points that I want you to take away from those, if they should happen to give you anything to look at on those. Okay, so the next piece in your book, if we look at 420, I don't like podiatry. Feet are...
I bet it is, but they stink.
I had my son at the airport. We went in and I was like, okay, is that your freaking feet?
Do you like your feet rubbed?
What's that?
Like your feet rubbed?
Do you like your feet rubbed?
I have a problem going and getting a pedicure every chance I get.
Well, it's funny because they don't have like.
But this is not good.
Because there aren't very many. Codes. It's a very small set of codes.
So you get used to coding.
You get used to it. But the funny thing is that I kind of feel bad because my boss, a lot of people that come in, most of them are older patients.
Yeah.
And they really think of it like going to get a pedicure.
Yeah.
Like they come in and he's like, you know, I'm doing other stuff besides that.
Right.
You know, debridement isn't just me clipping your toenail.
I worked for a podiatrist too, and you probably heard of him over time. He's in jail.
Oh. I feel bad.
You're quiet, buddy. You
In 2017, it got a little bit better because the codes changed for bunion surgery. Okay, and basically that's where, at least for me, the bulk of my podiatry coding came in, other than nails, was for bunion correction. I love the pictures that they have in CPT on pages 160 and 161. What I'm most grateful for in this new 2017 update is before these were referred to by what they would call legacy names. They were named after providers. So we had a Keller bunionectomy and a McBride bunionectomy and whoever. Mitchell, Chevron. Okay, there's four. I got four of them. But to know what they equated to, I relied heavily on the pictures. We no longer have to do that. They've brought it back to normal coding speak because as what happened is the industry changes, and this is why I love coding. As the industry changes, the practices change, and CPT has to grow as technology improves. So this is what happens. Like, I get a report, and it would be, I did a modified McBride. Okay, so now does your modified McBride become a Keller? Or does your modified McBride become a Mitchell? I have no, you know, those are things that I don't know. So they've made it more for the actual terms of what you need to know. Okay? Did they do an osteectomy? I know what that is. They cut the bone. Okay? Where did they cut it? Did they put a wire in there? Okay? Those are the things that I know, and that's now what the codes reflect. So it's beautiful.
You see how...
So if you look on page 420, just one sec. If you look on page 420, what they're referring to no longer holds true because they're talking about Keller types of procedures.
And in the exam for this chapter online, there is a question, and it threw me. I wasn't quite sure because it said which one of these procedures does not have to do with bunionectomies, and it listed a whole bunch of names.
It did the legacy names.
They had the legacy names, and then they had a shoulder procedure that was named after a person. And I'm going, okay, well, I remember in the book it's saying something about them all being named after stuff. So I thought that the correct answer to the question was silver. But there is, in fact, a silver bunionectomy procedure, and it was the bottom one, which when I was like, well, what the heck is that?
No,
and I looked it up, and it's like, oh, that's because it's the shoulder. That's why.
Okay. So. And see, that one I'm not familiar with, and I don't remember that being in
Apparently
CPT.
It's a popular one in podiatry. I don't know. I'm like, okay.
and without knowing, I'm glad they're getting away from the names and more towards actual terms. But I did want to point that out. If you're looking for that in your CPT, they're moving away from that. So this reference to Keller type procedure is now something completely different. It's been changed.
Now, though, wouldn't we as coders, if you're working in a like large practice, you're working where you may have to deal with a podiatrist, if the podiatrist is old school, they may still use the legacy and will need to know how to convert it, correct? In some situations.
In some situations, however, they still should be describing what that Keller procedure is to be able to help us get here.
Okay.
What the problem was before is when they would, in parenthetical notes, it would say like 28292, Keller type procedure. And it would just say bunionectomy, parentheses, Keller type procedure. And unless you knew, and like I said, I use the pictures a lot to know what the breakdown was, what differentiated each code from the other. Okay. Cass, did you have something you wanted to add?
I just had a question. I don't know if you can answer. You see like bunions here.
Yeah.
Can your feet... Your toes go the other way, so you have the bunion on the smaller toe? I know it sounds dumb, but the reason I ask is
they
can my baby
shift.
Toes are going this way, They're not. My big toes are not going that way.
Typically, it's on the large toe, but there are other procedures where they have to do corrective surgery to the other toes. It's not necessarily called a bunion,
my baby
but
toes
they
are
would do
up
something.
My next toe's over. They so would, I have to put like a toe separator because my toe goes right up.
They would.
The
Yeah, they would have codes for that. Usually it's some kind of, again, osteectomy. They take bones out to realign it, but there are other codes for that.
Don't tell me that.
If not other stuff. I mean, I'm not a surgeon. I just play one in my day job, but that's about
well,
it.
Well, I'm sure I could ask my father's wife because she's like, she loves to have you ask questions about, you know, like, and she'll go into the detail, blah, 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 blah. My father's like, oh.
Right. So, but just from what I read, that's what it is.
Well,
cause okay,
I'm
so
atypical, you know, like most people's toes go this way, mine are going this way.
Yeah. Okay, so application of casts and strapping. We talked about a little bit about this when we went over fracture care last week and that global thought of fracture care. If a patient is receiving fracture care or a fracture care code, casts and strapping would not be separately reported. Now, one of the things, and these rules are pretty definitive, and if you look on page 164 of your CPT, there's paragraphs of guidelines there that tell you, basically give you more detail, but in summary, the Cliff Note version is they're not reported with fractures. They're not reported with dislocations. You know,
it's
there's
all
kinds of rules. Yeah, it's all inclusive. There's all kinds of rules of when they can be reported.
It's like even if you have a fracture, you have to have, you probably have a cast.
Right. Just
sort.
Like after they've opened you up, you usually have some kind of dressing. It's the same principle.
If you're stitched up or whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
It's the same principle. Okay, so when they're strapping, they're taping a body part. Okay, it's used to exert pressure on a body part to give it more stability and is used in treatment of sprains, strains, and dislocations. Okay, now where our providers are having, at least my providers are having problems, are the splint codes. Splints are made of wood, cloth, metal, or plastic, as illustrated over here, are used to immobilize, support, or protect a body part, thereby allowing rest and healing. Okay, but it is something that the provider or the surgeon has to construct. They can't go into the supply closet, pull a splint off the shelf, Velcro it on, and then apply one of these codes, if it was applicable to code. Okay. We're not talking about prefabricated splints here.
So
we're
talking about like a pneumatic boot or anything like that. That's something
right.
Totally separate.
Totally separate.
Okay.
Totally
something
separate.
He sort of concocts himself.
Right. They have to think, and the best way I've been able to get it across is it's no different than it's in the same section as cast. A cast, while there are air casts, yes, there are. But it's still a prefabricated. What we're talking about here with casts are the old-fashioned plaster.
Plaster.
Yeah, plaster casts with plaster and gauze. The physician's wrapping it and then putting the plaster on. They're creating it specifically for that patient. That's what they're being reimbursed for. If they're taking one off from a shelf, a splint off from a shelf in the supply closet, putting it on, Velcroing it in under 30 seconds, that's not what this code is representing. Okay? So
sense,
just
though.
Make that distinction if you
so
see that.
So a note here should be these are not prefab.
Right. Not
the splints
that we're talking about, the casts that we're talking about, are not prefabricated supplies.
Not to prefab.
I'm on three. I have the wrong page.
Okay.
And
while you're writing, I'll just keep going. But I just wanted to note, it says on 421, if the cast, strapping, or splint is applied as part of fracture repair, the application service is not separately reported. They do talk about some, if a subsequent cast, strapping, or splint is applied within the follow-up period, you can bill the application okay, in those instances. Another time when serial applications of casts would be done is for clubfoot casting, okay, for infants when their feet turn in. It's a clubfoot, and they go in and they do a tenotomy. That first one isn't when they actually do the corrective procedure, but it's one of these that as the infant grows, as the child grows, they have to keep changing the cast to keep pace with the growth of the patient. Those subsequent ones are then billable. Now, there's another note on here on page 421, and we talked about this a little bit last week too, the supply codes, these HCPCS codes. And again, we'll talk about HCPCS codes in Chapter 9 next week. But these materials that they're billing for, it depends on who incurred the cost originally. Remember that.
So what is it?
Wait, where is that?
Okay, so they're saying that they could also bill for materials, A4580 to A4590. But if this is a hospital and the surgeon's going in, the surgeon isn't going to be able to report that. The hospital would report that because they're the ones that are doing the supplies, purchasing the supplies.
Okay, so a patient goes into a hospital, that's a procedure. The surgeon is going to bill for what he did.
Right.
He's not going to bill for, like, any of the instrumentation or any,
right.
None of that.
Right.
So my procedure is going to have a bill from an x-ray person who came in. So that x-ray department is going to send a bill to my insurance company for the x-ray to see whether I needed the surgery. The lab people who took my blood, they're going to bill totally separate codes.
Yep.
A surgeon is, and then
the hospital
itself, and then that would be
anesthesia.
Like the
facility.
What is that department? No, it's not materials. There's a materials department
supplies.
In every hospital.
Sure.
And their job is to say, oh, okay, Dr. So-and-so did this procedure, and this follow-up person did this procedure. Okay, that means we can bill for the supplies, not
correct.
For the procedure. So it's only those A codes that they're
it
billing.
Could be. Right.
Okay.
And anesthesia. So you could get five. When you go in for one surgery, you could get bills from five different departments, possibly.
I don't know if you can answer this question because you work in billing, but say you go to the hospital for a procedure and you apply for free care at the hospital. Does that mean, okay, so all you get is the actual hospital things
itself?
It should
be everything.
It
should be.
I had a situation like that, so now I have $2,000 in anesthesia and pathology bills that they denied.
All right. I know I shouldn't do this, but I'll share.
Why do I apply for free care? Why did I apply for free care when I... Because they thought I was bleeding internally.
Yeah.
So I had... My iron was so low, so I had to go have colonoscopies. I had no insurance. So I went and had it. Now I got pathology bills and anesthesia bills, and all the anesthesia was shot in the arm. That's $1,000. And my bills are in collection because they didn't cover them.
What should happen, and this is actually, I had to research this not that long ago. I had to have a gallbladder out on the 4th of July. I was under the knife instead of enjoying the things. But one of the things was, and because I had heard of this before happening, but I went to a hospital that was in network for me, okay? And so because I am who I am, everybody that came and touched me, I asked them if they were part of the hospital or if they were an independent contractor. And I'll tell you, they had me on some pretty good pain medication, and the nurses would look at me and say, is she serious? And my boyfriend was like, if she's asking you these questions, she's serious. She wants an answer. And they were looking around, and then the second person was like, am I on candy camera? And he's like, just answer the question. Just answer the question. But I did. I had a colleague who went to have surgery. She was in network, but the anesthesiologist, the pathologist, and the radiologist were not. And the ruling, so she got exorbitant bills from those individuals from this. However, there are rules out there that are to protect consumers. Unfortunately, consumers' patients aren't necessarily aware of all of these rules.
See, exactly.
You get a bill, you pay a bill. I get a bill, I scrutinize, and you know, because I do what I do. And I know there are mistakes
when you're sick,
and that's exactly it. It's like, yep, give me the paper, I'll give you whatever you need. And you sign. 2 months later, when the bills start coming in, it's like, why is this not paid? And when you do some questions, but there are rules, to your point, that say it should be under the same blanket. Even if these independent contractors are not supposed to be, they should be reimbursed at the same rate as an independent. Because who would know?
So who is to ask
all of those questions when they're in there?
If they're not under it or whatever you say, who pays them?
The providers are supposed to be able to negotiate, are supposed to be willing. If they're coming in, they're supposed to be able to negotiate and accept the same rate of payment.
But like I
said,
they
were
in
network,
free care for that. And
you should send those back.
The anesthesia and the pathology, who pays them? If I'm getting bills, but I have free care, so I should get it all free, then who pays them their share? Hospital?
Yeah, it should be under the hospital. Most of it's written off, to be quite honest, and then they take a big tax deduction at the end of the year.
You'd be amazed at how much gets written off.
Exactly.
It's sad. I didn't know what to do because, like I said, they said I was bleeding internally, and I'm like, well, am I going to die tomorrow? Well, I had to have colon and endoscopy at the same time.
Go back to the hospital and ask. Yeah. So that's my piece on that part. All right, on page 422, endoscopy, arthroscopy, okay? This is one of those, after we get past the musculoskeletal system, we didn't deal with this in integumentary because it's on the surface, okay? But now that we're actually in the body, endoscopy, arthroscopy, it's the minimally invasive. So they're making just a few little puncture marks, and then they're going in with a scope and sometimes a robot for the visualization. Instead of making a long incision, it helps promote healing. It helps get the patient on their feet faster. So these are preferable types of procedures. But the endoscopy, arthroscopy codes in the musculoskeletal system are at the end of musculoskeletal system. As we get into all of the other systems, cardiac, digestive, urinary, neuro, they're woven in to the sections. There's not a specific group for all of these to occur. Okay? So in here, these endoscopy, arthroscopy codes start on page 167. It starts, again, using that hierarchy, starts with the temporomandibular joint, so starts at the head, and it will end at the toes, or end at the feet. So we have shoulder surgery, and all the shoulder procedures, rotator cuff would be in there as well, if they did it that way. Then it comes down to the elbow. There are some in the wrist, okay? This isn't where your carpal tunnels are, by the way. Kind of spoiler alert. But even if they're using a minimally invasive approach, our carpal tunnels are back in the neuro section. Wrist surgery, knees, all your knee surgery is in here.
No, I had to laugh because when I had my carpal tunnel surgery, I didn't tell my doctor. I was going back to work the next day, and I didn't tell my work I was having it done.
Oh, gosh. And then, so all of those are in here. There's lots of rules around arthroscopic surgery. It depends. For example, and I think I highlighted it here, so they can, if they do an arthroscopic approach and do it in conjunction with an arthrotomy, so they end up opening the patient, they can add, you can add modifier 51. It just notes that if the surgeon performs an arthroscopic during the procedure, extends the procedure to an arthrotomy, both services are reported.
It says it in the CPT too, right? Yeah. At the beginning of the section, it says when arthroscopy is performed in conjunction with arthrotomy, add modifier 51.
Right. And that will change. This is the only time that's another good way to think about it. But when we talk about scope procedures that are then converted to open procedures, we can't report both once we get past this musculoskeletal. But we can here, okay? Diagnostic arthroscopies are always bundled. They usually have that separate procedure distinction on there, so they can't be, So if you look at, for example, 29830, a diagnostic arthroscopy at the elbow.
29830?
Yep. 29830 on page 168. It's the second code down. Mm-hmm. With or without synovial biopsy, okay, so testing the fluid that's in there. It's a separate procedure, okay? And remember, that separate procedure distinction will tell you that we're expecting, if you're reporting more than one code, we'd expect that to be bundled. The only way that we could report it separately is if it was on the opposite side, a separate location, or something completely different, like a knee was done.
So that's modifier 59, right?
Then it would be a modifier 59 on that code. You're right.
Now, what is, I had here, normally 51 is less used, but it is used, referred back here in the endoscopy. It's 51. Yes. What's the difference between 51 and 59, I guess?
51 just notes that it's a subsequent procedure. It's a multiple procedure modifier.
Okay.
So, and typically what happens when you have more than one CPT, the first one is paid at 100%. I think we might have talked about this.
Yeah.
And then the second one is usually 50% and then 25%. And every payer has a different rate of payment. It usually progresses down pretty rapid. But it just tells them that there was more than one procedure that was performed so that they can take those reductions on the other ones. There are some, and to your point, Marty, they aren't very widely used on coding. I still use them all the time just out of habit, but a lot of payers have what they call edits in their system where if they get a claim and there's more than one, they're automatically going to put them on there. I find it a good habit to keep putting them on there so that the payers aren't necessarily inclined to put the highest paid code in a second or third position, let's say. Okay?
Right. They'll do that if you're putting
so much code.
Right. So does that make sense?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So it makes more sense for us to code properly in that putting the correct highest value first and then putting the others and add the modifiers just so that we make sure that when it goes to the insurance that the system doesn't automatically change something that will end up having the provider get paid less.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Because, not that they all do, but there are some instances where they might put them and I don't know how they do it, but it could be something as arbitrary as they put them in numerical order instead of RVU order. But if you force them to look at the order that you put them in, it's a good idea to keep using those.
That's a good practice, you're right.
Yeah, it is.
Because you get screwed out of money.
Right.
So can 51 be 59 used interchangeably?
51 and 59, I talk about families, okay? So there are certain modifiers that are related, but probably shouldn't be together. So 51 and 59.
Dysfunctional family.
Don't marry your cousin. Yeah.
They're the same, okay? But all it's saying is they're related in that they both indicate those multiple procedures. But
right.
59 is saying that we know that it should be bundled, but it shouldn't. So there are, usually it's an either or situation, okay? Usually 51 and 59, but it's an either or. You typically wouldn't report. There are some payers that want both, but typically you'd report either or. Okay. So all set? Did that answer that? Okay.
Yeah.
On page 423, when coding arthroscopic procedures of the knee, note the use of basket forceps, which indicates a meniscectomy, meniscus removal, rather than a shaving and debridement. Okay, so that's one where a tool is helping to drive that code selection. It's important to know that there are three different compartments in the knee. There's the medial, lateral, and patellofemoral. That also can help determine whether codes can be, because if they're in, some of them are broken down. Oh, where is it? Okay. So 29882, for example, with meniscus repair, so they're doing a meniscectomy, okay? They're taking some of that, and then they're repairing. No, that's not true. Okay, it's either they're doing a meniscectomy or they're doing a meniscus repair. Let's just look at 29882. Okay, all of these are arthroscopies for the knee. So if they're doing a knee arthroscopy with a meniscus repair, in parentheses, it's medial or lateral. Okay? If it's both, we're looking at another code. But let's say that they did a meniscus repair in the medial, and then they did... Oh, I don't know. Let's just pick something. A chondroplasty, and let's pretend it really doesn't bundle because there's no rule here that says it doesn't. And then they did a chondroplasty in the lateral component. We're in separate places, okay? We're in different components of the knee. So medial is on one side, lateral is on the other. Patellofemoral is actually behind the kneecap. So there's three different areas that they can be working in. If they encounter or introduce different procedures in each one, there's a consideration to bill those separately with modifier 59. Okay?
Okay.
All right. So that's why it's important to note those three compartments. We don't really get into different compartments that much with other joints. Okay. If the procedure is began as a diagnostic and then converts to a surgical procedure, we already discussed that, and I hope that's clear. It's not separately reported. It's only reported as the surgical.
Right.
Yeah.
The more expensive of the two.
Correct. At that point. Okay. We talked a little bit, again, about separate procedure. Okay, and that finishes musculoskeletal, and I think I actually will have time to do all of respiratory. Any questions so far? Okay. All right, so the respiratory system. Okay, again, using this hierarchy, starts at the nose and goes to the lungs, all right, and all stops in between. So your knowledge of, and you've had medical terminology and anatomy, right? Okay, good, good, good. All right.
Well, so you took anatomy too?
I took terminology with the CMA.
Okay. So the anatomy of the respiratory system is going to be very important in this section. I mean, it's important all the way through. It's difficult to code if you're not sure of your anatomic landmarks, but it's really important here in the respiratory system, and I'm going to take a little bit of time to talk about that tonight. So there's always points of reference, and this is another thing, especially as you're in your exam, is to make sure you know where these tools are. So in the book, so on page 171, all right, and I'm getting ahead of myself, I know, again, but on page 171 of your CPT, there was more. Maybe there's not in this
one.
There's
one on 172, too.
I thought there was a whole... I think about my other book. But on page 171 is a picture of your sinuses. Okay? So there are four different sinus cavities that you'll need to know for the nose. It kind of goes along with what we were just talking about for the knee. Ah, there they are. Okay. So tools like this that are at the front of your CPT book will also help. Okay. I thought there was more too. Maybe it's the ICD-10
of the terminology and the physiology of the upper respiratory, the upper respiratory was those sinus.
Yeah.
Sinus and bones, because ethmoid and sinoid, it's like I would always flip those.
Yeah.
So I had to come up with something to like help me remember, okay, which one, like I'd have to always visualize a profile of a person so that I could go, okay, the ethmoid is in front.
Yes.
It's on the end.
Right.
And the other one is on the inside. So right. Remember, EN.
Right. And that is acronyms, that kind of stuff always helps me. But this is a good reference point when we get into sinus discussions. And then on page 172, it's not great, but it will get the job done. So it gives us the nasal cavity, the nasopharynx. The nasopharynx is where, from the nose, and that's where you get the postnasal drip, dripping down the back of your throat, causing you to cough. That nasopharynx, the oropharynx, also where your uvula and tonsils can be located, is in the oropharynx. Then the epiglottis is that little flap that directs traffic between air and food, from the respiratory to the digestive system. Larynx, your vocal cords, and the beginning of some of your airway there. And then esophagus, of course, that's not part of our respiratory system, but they're all in there together, okay? Esophagus, trachea, and then we have the bronchi, the left lung, the right lung, okay? The other thing I wanted to point out, and I'll have to email you my reference. I have a tool that I found online that shows. Well, make sure you get it.
I have a printer and everything.
But I always thought that we were mirror image. We're not, okay? Your left and your right lung don't have the same number of lobes. And I don't remember which one is which, but one has three and one has two. And then they break down into different segments as well. So I want to say the right.
Heart.
Yeah, I want to say
the
left.
It's the right lung. The right lung has three because it's in the picture.
Right.
That's what
on
I said.
Page
because the left is the heart. So how can you know it stands to reason?
I think that's
in
right.
In this picture, it shows it.
Oh
yeah. The little light.
Thank
lines.
You. Okay, I was hoping there'd be something to help me.
I think
clue
I'm gonna
in.
Photocopy this and paste it into
there you
the
go.
Book so that I have both pictures to look at.
But so when we get into lung resections, just keep that in mind, that the right has 3 and the left has 2. There are different rules depending on how many lobes and things that they're that you're dealing with, but just keep that in mind, that we're not perfect, we're not symmetrical, and the left is in a mirror image of the right, okay, especially when it comes to lungs. Okay, so in the musculoskeletal subsection, like I said, we talked about the arthroscopy codes are placed at the end, but in the respiratory system, we're talking about endoscopy, okay? So, and in this case, arthroscopic procedures that we talked about in musculoskeletal, they have to make incisions in order to get that scope in there. There's no other way. But when we talk about endoscopic codes in the respiratory system, they're using natural orifices, okay? So typically the nose or the mouth to get to where they need to go. All right.
That is the nastiest thing to have done. I mean, they knock you out, but they give you this stuff.
Yeah. All the stuff you have to drink, that you have to be stuff
and you're like, oh, my God.
So procedures that are performed on the throat or mouth, and we talked about that a little bit, and this is where we kind of get that crossover. But throat and mouth are going to be in the 40,000 section when we start with the digestive, okay? It just makes more sense that that's in the digestive, and the nose is our point of reference for the respiratory. But they can still access the respiratory system through the mouth. Just want to make sure that's clear. Some of these codes, especially when we're talking about the nose codes, can be cosmetic in nature. And just like we talked about in the integumentary system, when we're talking about plastics codes, the responsibility often comes on whether there's medical necessity or not. Okay? So a patient that is born with, some kind of severe deformity that doesn't permit them to breathe normally through both nostrils, they might be receiving some of these rhinoplasty codes, whereas somebody that just can't accept the fact that we're not perfect and the left isn't the same as the right, they might be looking to have this corrected with some of these procedures. But we'd still code them the same way, except for on the diagnosis part. The CPTs would be the same. It's just how they got paid would be different. Okay, so rhinoplasty, which is the correction of the nose, can be performed either through external skin incisions or through the natural orifice, okay, through intranasal incisions. Regardless of their approach, both would be reported with 30400. Okay. Normally we have distinctions, but in this case for a rhinoplasty, 30400, I'm on page 428 in your book and on page 173 in your CPT. Those rhinoplasty codes, it doesn't matter the approach.
Okay, wait, what's the number again?
30400.
Okay.
Okay, under codes. Repair. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, and we don't need to, I won't go into how they can actually do these rhinoplasties, but there's a number of different ways that they can achieve them. And again, it would be those same sections of codes. There could be a secondary code, 304-300, if the patient had already received one nose procedure and was coming back in for a second one, then we'd be looking at those secondary codes.
So 304.
Okay, so the 30400, it doesn't matter.
Right.
What the approach is.
Right. They can be coming external, okay, or they can go in through the nostrils intranasally. Okay, and they consider the intranasal incisions to be closed. Okay, here again it's been a theme and it will continue to be a theme throughout of all of coding, but here it's really relevant too. If there's, we can't code components of the procedure separately if there's one code that includes all the components. So for example, all right, I know there's one where they talk about septal repair being inclusive. I'm not seeing it right now. Okay, I don't see it. I'll come back to that.
So
for example, if they're doing a correction to doing a rhinoplasty, fixing the nose, and at the same time they're fixing the septum, okay, that cartilage
that's like
part different. That's in there. There are some times where that could be separately reported. There are some times when they address the septum that it's considered inclusive to the code. And I can't. I thought I had it written down.
How
I might. It will say in the description, with or without septoplasty,
okay.
Septoplasty or include septoplasty.
So this one,
I know I'm going to
30420, including major septal repair.
Okay,
so
there we go.
So if we were doing three, so if the physician, if we're reading the report and it says rhinoplasty, blah, 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 but then it says in addition to major septal repair, or the septal repair that they're describing sounds like it's very involved, then we would use 30420 as opposed to 30400.
Correct.
Okay.
Instead of doing 30400 and then 30520. Because 30520 represents the septoplasty.
Okay.
And that's usually used for deviated septums, the 30520. That's why it's so, I'm familiar with that one. But okay, so we talked about the orifice parts. Also, okay, we have two nostrils, one mouth, but usually when they're doing these procedures, except for the case of diagnostic endoscopy, that can be unilateral or bilateral. So again, it should just be cluing you in to, if they're coming through the nose, what are they investigating, or are they just using this as a route to something further down? Or are they looking in the nose and just stopping in the nose, maybe the sinus cavities or getting as far back as the nasopharynx, and then they're taking it out and coming through the other one? Those approaches, realistically, could be coded as bilateral, okay? Whereas most of the other ones, even if they came in through one, but their target was, let's say, the trachea, and they go through one of the nostrils, and maybe they couldn't navigate as well as they'd like to, so they take it out and they go through the other nostril to get to the path they need to.
It's still
going to be one, okay?
Right, it's still the same code because it says 31231. It says nasal endoscopy, diagnostic, uneral or bilateral. And then it says separate procedure in parentheses.
Okay, so they didn't. They didn't distinguish. I was taking that they.
But then.
Okay.
Okay, but there are other procedures that you might need to do.
You might need to consider the bilateral.
Yeah, I mean, that's just, the first code is, it looks like it's just a diagnostic nasal endoscopy. And then it says unilateral or bilateral, so it doesn't matter. And then it says separate procedure.
Right.
So that means that it wasn't in conjunction with any kind of a surgical or repair.
Okay, which one are you looking
at
again?
It's 31231. It's the first one under endoscopy.
Yes, that one is unilateral or bilateral.
Right.
No, but let's say as we keep going down through, okay.
So say 31235.
Okay, 31235. That one could be bilateral, because now we're talking about sphenoids.
Okay.
And going into looking at the sphenoid sinuses, which we do have two of. So we could go bilateral there.
Okay.
Let me just make sure before I hop into those that there isn't something else. Okay. No. All right. So one of the things that I wanted to point out on here, if we look on page 175. Okay. And again, we have a nice picture on page 176 of a close-up of these sinus cavities that goes very nicely with all of the codes that are in here. Now, what I wanted to point out to you on here is, let's say, as you were sharing earlier, Kim, if they're looking at more than one sinus, every sinus that they enter can and do something in, even if it's usually they have to remove tissue or a polyp or something like that. Those can be separately reported. But if you look at the parenthetical notes, there are significant parenthetical notes under each one of these codes on page 176, meaning, okay, let's just look at one for example, okay? One of my favorites. So, 31267.
31267.
Yeah.
Okay.
As a nasal endoscopy, surgical endoscopy of the maxillary sinus. Okay. So, if you want, it's a big one. It's right under your eye. You can, you know, when you have one of those wonderful sinus colds and your cheeks are all puffy, it's probably all in your maxillary sinus. Okay, so let's say that there was, let's say there's a polyp in there, and they're going to remove that tissue from the maxillary sinus on the left side. Let's say that they were going to do some other stuff too. If they were going to do a biopsy in there, we couldn't separately report it. But if they also go into the anterior and posterior ethmoid, and the frontal sinus, with or without removal of polyps, they're giving you the codes that you'd report for visiting or treating all three of those. They're telling you you'd report a 31255, a 31256, and a 31276.
Okay,
wait a minute.
Oh, there it is. Okay.
Okay. Yep. So it's not, I mean, you're still going to want to go through the process and make sure, but they're giving you the directions of what happens when you're doing procedures in multiple sinuses. They're giving you the series of codes that you should be looking at. Does that make sense?
Now, with
okay,
that,
Marty
would
gave
you
me a thumb.
Also do that by most expensive? I would assume it's the one that you have to get in the furthest to would be the most expensive.
Typically,
okay.
Yes. Yep, typically. Usually what you have to do and where you have to go would drive the
cost.
Yep, the value of it. Okay? But I wanted to make sure that that was pointed out because there are times, like let's look at 31276, for example. There's all kinds of combinations that can happen there. The very last one on page 377 that relates to that code, they're suggesting there are five different codes.
You mean 177?
Yes, excuse me, 177. There are a potential of five different codes that you'd need to look at and could report in conjunction for all of these sinus surgeries. Okay, so they did help us out a little bit here, but it's also a guideline, a clear guideline to make sure that it's that you know that it's not something that they're not bundled, for example. They can be separately reported. Okay. All right. Oh, there it is. There was my note to do that. Okay. Now, back in your textbook on page 429, endoscopic procedures may start at one site, such as the nose, and follow to another site, such as the larynx. But let's say that you know, they're taking the scenic route, and while they're going through the nose, they're making sure that the nose is okay. As they're proceeding to the larynx, yep, the oropharynx, the naropharynx is okay. We're not coding for each one of those. We're coding for the furthest spot that they get to. Okay? So as you're going on vacation and you're driving to California, you might stop at different places on the way, but when you tell people you're going on vacation, where are you going? I'm going to California. You don't tell them that you stop, you know, that you're going to Chicago and Denver and all of those places on the way. Okay? Same principle.
So the coding to extent and coding to the approach, that should just go under endoscopy? Or should that be a...
That should just go under endoscopy.
Okay.
Okay? Coding to extent, coding for approach should just go under endoscopy. Now, again, I don't know when... This could be months from now that we get to there. But there's another code that goes with these codes. It actually lives back in the medicine section, and it's 92511. Okay? And I'm only telling you this because this one is specific for viewing the nasopharynx. All right?
Okay.
And oftentimes, the providers, there's some gray area on whether you report one of these codes, the 32. I think it's a 3, what'd you say it was? A 32511? No, 31231. Okay, so over here on page 175, under your endoscopy codes, just write yourself a note.
On which one?
On page
175. Okay.
Under the endoscopy section, just write yourself a note. Do you need to look at CPT 92511.
What's the number again?
92511.
Is where we need to look.
You might need to consider that one if they're stopping at the nasopharynx. They don't usually, but if they were doing an endoscopic review of the nasopharynx, that's the code you'd be looking for. Okay? I don't know why it's all the way back there and not up here.
But
there
it is. You code to the furthest point you go in?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Code to the full extent, meaning the furthest spot.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
As far as
that, and then
code the approach.
Okay. Great. Okay.
So you code the approach and how far in you go.
The approach being whether it would be open or an endoscopic, but we're looking at if they're going through the nose and it's
So you have two different codes.
Right. No, you have one code, whatever the full extent is, but you want to, if it's an endoscopic code, that's your approach, the endoscopic.
Full extent.
But the full extent. Let's say that they did...
It's incisional. It would be different.
Right.
Gotcha.
It would be different, but it would still be the furthest extent that they get to. So, surgical procedure may be performed using different approaches, okay? And we kind of talked about this. So, it could be a thoracotomy, okay? They could need to open the patient up. Or it could be a surgical thoracoscopic. Okay, or thoracoscopic.
A little incision.
Yeah, it would be a little incision, and then they, just like with the knees and all of those, little tiny incision, they put a camera in there with the tools. Usually there's more than one incision, and they put tools in there. We'll get to it in a little bit, but this thoracoscopic approach is also known as VATS. That's the acronym, V as in Victor, ATS, and it's video assisted thoracoscopic surgery. Okay, VATS. So oftentimes the providers will put that. I did a VATS of what, and that's what that correlates to. It just means they're using a minimally invasive approach, thoracoscopic procedure. Okay, multiple endoscopic procedures may be performed through the same scope during the operative session. When it occurs, we should be reporting each subsequent with a 51. Okay? The exception to this occurs when the CPT manual offers a code for which the description includes all the separate elements of the procedure bundled into one code. And I'd like to add that the other exception would be there's a lot of add-on codes. Again, especially when we talk about lung resections with the high rate of lung cancer, there's a lot of that, especially if a patient has multiple lesions in different aspects of the lung, they're allowed to bill for each part of the lung that they go to, as long as it's not...
Even if it's on the same side?
If it's on the same side, but not the same lobe. So that's where different lobes come.
So one on each lobe. That and it's on the same side, then that's fine.
Right.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. Okay, remember again, and we've talked about this ad nauseum, but a diagnostic endoscope is always bundled into the surgical endoscope. That concept has not changed and will not change. Diagnostic endoscopic nasal procedure, and then they continue on to complete a surgical procedure. You'd only report the surgical procedure.
You didn't bring your water bottle.
I did. I've got it over here.
There you go.
I'm trying not to.
Why? You should. Don't you need dry out?
What goes in goes out. All right.
That is true.
Yeah, and I'd like to try and make it all 3 hours. Okay, so if we go to on page 430, if a diagnostic sinus endoscopy is performed on the right maxillary sinus and a surgical maxillectomy on the left, both procedures would be reported with appropriate RT and LT modifiers. And I don't remember if we've talked about RT, LT before.
Yeah.
Those are, we have, okay, they're informational.
Right.
If you can use them, you should use them. Okay.
The more information they have, the better, right?
Right. Right. And a 50 wouldn't be appropriate here because they're two different procedures. Okay. They're doing a maxillectomy in one, and then they're just doing a diagnostic sinus endoscopy on the other. Okay. The contralateral side was more extensive. That's why we're not looking at a 50. Okay. We can't give them more, and we certainly shouldn't give them less. All right. Oh, this is a good one. Okay. When reporting laryngoscopy procedures, note that there's terms indirect and direct when we look at those codes. So let's turn there for just a second. On page 177 is the beginning. And again, we have some guidelines that have changed here. Oh, that's a big one, but I won't get into that tonight because I still don't know how we're going to solve it. all of these codes, there was like 400, I think the count is 445 of these codes. Most of the scopes, so nasal endoscopies, laryngoscopies, esophagoscopies, colonoscopies, all used to include moderate sedation. They did away with it completely this year. So now these providers can separately report moderate sedation if they're the ones that are administering it. There are all kinds of rules under what has to be documented in order for them to get it. For eons, they've never had to, so the point of them being able to qualify for that is probably not going to happen, but I do have some doctors that have already started asking what they need to do because they've understood that these RVUs have been reduced, the values of these codes have been reduced now that they've taken that out, and the expectation is they need to have additional documentation to bill separately. It's going to be that was a big thing. That was my day today. I was talking about that for a couple hours. So I will share with you what that looks like once we've dove into it a little bit further. But that was a big piece here. that's a lot of what you'll see in the revisions. When you look through here on page 179, there's a lot of little blue triangles for revision codes. That's what it is, because there used to be what looked like a bullet, a bullseye symbol next to all of these codes, meaning they included moderate sedation. They did away with the symbol and they did away with the concept starting this year. So that's now that we're in here, most of these blue triangles that you see throughout CPT, that's what it's reflecting. Okay. So the very first code in here, back to my point, 31505 for the first laryngoscopy diagnostic code. In between there is that term indirect. Okay. Think of the old-fashioned doctor that comes in, puts a tongue depressor on your tongue and says, open up and say, ah. He's looking at your vocal cords when he makes you say, ah, but that's an indirect approach. He's just visualizing with what he has. It's not direct. Okay. When we talk about 31515, and you'll notice there aren't that many codes for that, because the chances of them doing some of these procedures in the larynx without some assistance from a direct tool is not likely, but there are some. So if it's a direct approach, then they're using scopes and they're actually in proximity of the larynx, okay, to be able to visualize it more thoroughly. Okay, so just make sure that you're noting those distinctions. There's also one other little deviation that happens in here in 31515 and 31520. 31520 and 31525, diagnostic for a newborn or a non-newborn. Okay.
So that means that anybody else except
a newborn. Yeah. And oftentimes they'll give a definition for newborn, like there's a modifier 63. Newborn is usually 28 days or less,
right,
unless it's a preemie, and then they go by weight. Okay. Okay, so a lot of those codes are for, like I said, a lot of these codes are direct or indirect, and that's what drives them. The majority of them are direct codes. Okay, what else did I want to make sure that we talked about? Okay. So it's now having us go back. I didn't look at the structure here, but I guess it makes sense the way they're doing it. So if we go back to the beginning on page 173 in your CPT book, under the nose section, again, we have that consistency, incision, excision, introduction, removal of foreign body, repair, and then destructions, other procedures, and we start following that premise, and now we have those arthroscopic or endoscopic codes introduced in there as well. Okay, but when we're talking about these nose codes, most of these are going to be used by a specialist, an otolaryngologist or an ENT doctor. There are also many codes in here that are more widely used. For example, think cauterization for a nosebleed, removal of foreign bodies from the nose. Your family practitioner is going to have probably a lot of those.
Every pediatrician in the world has probably done a removal of foreign bodies.
Exactly.
I was thinking about this, you know, how they say remove yet in your head from someone's ass.
Yeah, could be. Yep. So
my daughter, the exact same thing in her nose twice.
No, boy.
It's like you stuck the bead in your nose the first time. I managed to get it out. Then she stuck the exact same bead another day in her nose. I'm like, did you not remember what happened last time? And it pivoted. So we had to bring her into the doctor, and they had to take it.
My niece had to go in and have a move because it was this way. And I'm like, me and my sister both said, we'll put a glove on, we'll do it. I'm not for me. I'm like, you want to go have a stranger do it and pay him.
Artie's going to have a story. He's smiling over there.
Yeah.
We have a story of someone putting something up the nose. It's got to be.
But I'm going there.
Okay. But there, I mean, for the most part, these are will be for specialists. But just like when I, like I said, I went over the integumentary codes a lot because every specialty will be using the skin codes. They at some point, they just have to. They just have to. But there is the possibility and the plausibility that these other specialists will have to use some of these codes as well, not just the specialists for that area. Okay, removal of nasal cysts, nasal lesions, that could also be some of your general practitioners. Again, it's very important to make sure that you're understanding when they say the nose, are they in or out? Okay, if they're outside, we're integumentary. If they're in, okay, like for the removal of a cyst, for example, if it was intranasal, we're looking at a 30,000 code. If it's on the outside, like our one that we had earlier on the ALA, remember that? Then we're looking at integumentary.
Okay.
Okay. On page 431 is just another, what I felt was a good diagram, a good place to just reinforce that. So there are other pieces where it depended on whether they're dealing with the nasal mucosa or the septal mucosa. So again, looking for those points of reference, knowing where that anatomy is and how it affects, okay? When we talk about INDs or incision and drainage, I know what's in here, but anyway, if they're just opening it, getting the purulence out and letting it heal on its own, that's one. But if they're doing packing, I thought this was a really good picture of what packing of an abscess looks like. They take this thread-like gauze material and they'll put just on the end of some kind of... Then they leave a wick and they'll instruct the patient that after so many days, somebody or the patient needs to pull that wick out and get all of the, and then it will heal. That usually constitutes a more complex or complicated approach. Usually it will say too. Okay. The insertion and removal of the tube and or gauze and any, that's all bundled. It's not separately reported. Okay. But as I said, it may drive whether it's simple or complicated or complex. Okay. When we're looking at these excision codes, there's a wide range of procedures that can describe the removal of tissue for the nose, biopsies, polyp excisions, cyst excisions, and then there's the resection of the turbinate bone, and I think Kim was alluding to that earlier. So inside the nose, there's these little, all I can think of is a seashell, like a conch shell. Okay, you know what I mean by a conch shell? That's underneath in your nose. And that's what these turbinates are. And there's actually three different turbinates. And if you look on page 432 shows it pretty good too, but it's all full of polyps. So we'll look at 433 for right now. There's a superior, middle, and inferior turbinate. Okay? And it's those bones. This is separate from your sinus. Your sinus are more in your cheek, in the soft tissue, and in your forehead. These are actually in your nose. Okay? But if you look on page, back to your CPT, if you look on page 173, The only codes that we have are for addressing the inferior terminate. Okay? The excision of the inferior terminate. The first code is partial or complete, 30130. Any method. Okay? If they're going down further and doing a submucosic or submucosal resection, so they're getting into that deeper tissue to remove the inferior terminate, partial or complete, any method, then it's a 30140. So the first one is more superficial in nature. The second one is deeper. But you'll notice that's it. Then we're done. There's no code for superior and no code for the middle terminate, even though all three exist. I don't know if the thought behind that is it's not likely that they're going to, because look where those nasal cavities are located, or those terminates are located in the nasal cavity. They're pretty up and far in there. If they're getting to those, they're telling us that we have to report a unlisted code. Okay, so the only one that has an established code is the terminate excision of the inferior, superior, and middle are unlisted. All right, and then just to keep things interesting, flip over to page 174 in your CPT manual. It's kind of a repeat, but now we have destruction. Okay, we had excision, now we have destruction. They're destroying those turbinate bones in the inferior section or in the inferior turbinate. But this time they're ablating it.
What would be a reason for having them and them?
If it was too large and was causing obstruction, is one. Yep. Yeah,
as one. Obviously, you probably have pain too, right?
There might be some pain. Usually, it's for difficulty breathing. It would be the one that I would think of the most. Okay, but again, thinking back to the example that I gave you before, in that one that I emailed, and we talked about, this isn't an, if it's not an excision, if they're using some other modality or some other method other than a knife or a sharp instrument, such as electrocautery, radio frequency, or other kind of tissue volume reduction, then we're looking at these destruction codes, but we have the same problem. There's nothing for superior and nothing for middle, only inferior. Okay? So just like before, I'd just write yourself a note so that you can, although I think they actually have a parenthetical. They do? Oh, yeah. No, they don't. They don't have a parenthetical that tells us to look at the next page if it's a different way. Okay.
So
the only parenthetical it tells us is that we can't report them together. If they do an excision and they do a destruction, we can't report those together unless, of course, it was on. They did one nasal and one.
So how did you word your note?
I just wrote no code for superior or middle turbinate. And that's what I put on the other page, too.
Yeah.
I was going to say.
And
it does, it does say at the bottom, 173 in the first column, for superior and middle, use 30999 at the bottom.
Right.
Of the
yeah.
Right.
Oh, for that, for the ablation.
Right. And okay. Then if you look at, but what I want to make sure.
Is that, an unlisted procedure knows.
Right. Those unlisted procedures, but also the difference between excision and destruction again. Because it doesn't, if they're using something other than a sharp, for lack of a better term, some kind of knife or something to take out that bone, if they're using radio frequency like they did in our one before right. For the nevus, then we're looking at destruction.
And if we use that unlisted code, that needs to be accompanied by a special report. Right?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Yep, it does. Okay. All right. right, I did that. Okay, oftentimes, I'm back in the book, I'm moving on page 433 in the book. Yeah, I'm going to get there, I am. All right.
433?
Yep, 433 in the book. Okay, and I know we kind of touched on this before. Because it's a natural orifice and because, you know, primarily children are children, the ones that would have this more often, foreign objects, if they go to report an office procedure for the removal of foreign body, it's 30300. However, if it's more significant and extensive, let's say they have to take them to the OR and the patient is under general anesthesia, then we're looking at a different code, 30310. Okay? But for just removing a bead from a nose with a couple of forceps and maybe some visualization, it's 30300. But if they actually end up needing to have surgical intervention, there's a different code for that.
No. This is if requiring general anesthesia, 30310. Now it says bilateral rhinotomy. So that means that if they need to be put under, that's one. But if they need to actually cut into the skin to get it,
yeah,
that's a different code.
Correct.
Okay.
Right. Because, if they actually have to cut the skin instead of using the weigh-in. Yeah. Good pick up there.
You talk about foreign bodies putting in the wrong place. I worked for a doctor's answering service, and the girl I worked with used to do radiology x-rays, and they were x-raying an elderly lady's pelvis, and they found Christmas tree bulbs in her vagina.
Oh, gosh. That's not good. Okay. On the repair codes, we talked a little bit about this before. About rhinoplasty and septoplasty. If they're doing both, make sure that there isn't a code that includes that as well. Basically, a septoplasty is just the rearrangement of the nasal septum. It's a very popular code, usually performed due to a deviated septum. It's that 30520, and if you look at on page 374,
174?
Yes, 174.
You know why you're doing it? It's because the book were in the 400s.
Yep, it's got to be. Okay, 174 is where that code is. Okay. And if they have to, with or without cartilage scoring, contouring, or replacement with graft, the graft would be included, and the graft is usually cartilage in nature as well. Okay, it might just be rearranging some of the cartilage that's already there to close that deviation. It wouldn't be separately reported. It's included in the code. Okay. All right, they're giving us a caution on 433. I'm pretty confident you'd be okay with this, but just to make note of it, do not use a septoplasty code if the operative report indicates that only a resection of the inferior turbinates was performed. Okay, it could be up against that septum, but just making sure that you're confident where the resection is occurring. The resection of inferior turbinates, as we've already discussed, is reported with 30140. Not a procedure performed on the septum. The septoplasty code 30520 is reported when the nasal septum is resected. There is a note enclosed in parentheses following both codes and cautions you to use the correct code, depending on whether the turbinate or septum was resected. Again, I don't see that being a big issue, but maybe in my little bubble, I haven't encountered it, but maybe it's more prevalent than I would think. Because for CPT to make note of it too. Okay, we talked about destruction a little bit. Intramural is ablation of deeper mucosa as compared to superficial ablation, which addresses only the outer layer of the mucosa. So those two ablation codes that we were looking at before for comparison when we were talking about excision, it's superficial or it's intramural. It's that deeper tissue. They just use a different term than they did in the excision codes. Okay. We talked about, just briefly, control of nasal hemorrhage, 30901, 30920. Again, usually there's something more involved in there. If they're coming to an office procedure, it could be that it's reported in an E&M. Usually there's some kind of, if we look at 30901, it's just simple packing, any method, okay? It's not going to be very invasive. That would be like your office type. But let's say that there's a significant perforation in one of the nasal vessels and they had to go in and cauterize that. Then we're looking at some of these further, okay, like a 30905. But we need to know whether it's located in the anterior portion of the nose or the posterior portion. So anterior would be towards the beginning. Posterior would be further up. Posterior, if they have to go all the way up, of course, would be the more extensive code there. So just note those two differences there in 30903 and 30905.
Okay, so figure 16.6 on page 434, that would be a picture of 30901.
Okay, 434.
Yep.
Yep, and then what?
16.6, figure 16.6, would that be a visual of 30901 in the CPT?
I would say yes, it would. And then, but this posterior one would be a 30905.
Okay.
All right. And like I said, they have to go a little bit further back. Okay. Yeah, we talked about that a little bit. The ethmoid, I couldn't remember the vessel up there. Ethmoid artery is what they normally have to ligate, okay, or the maxillary artery. A therapeutic fracture could occur of the nasal turbinate. The physician will fracture those turbinate bones and then reposition it under local anesthetic. If they're doing that in conjunction with a traumatic fracture, they wouldn't get both.
See, now I couldn't have someone doing that with a local anesthetic, someone in my face like that. I don't know how to explain it. I would have to be knocked out.
Yeah, I would too. Yeah.
Well, it's kind of like when you have your wisdom teeth removed, because a lot of times they don't put you under. I would have like a version of a local. I wasn't completely under, but it wasn't just a local, it was something more. I was out of it, but I could hear, you know, when they were pulling it out, I could hear the cracking and everything. I would think it would be the same kind of thing. You can hear it going on, but you're in.
No, they'd have to.
Well,
just like.
Oh, I don't know. I've always been out.
When I have
out.
My endoscopy, they blow my ass out. They are not going to just sedate me. I will gag, throw up. I don't know. I will flip out.
You can't. My dad woke up in the middle of. His endoscopy.
That's
a
nightmare.
Yeah, he freaked out every one of them. Runs. They're like, whoa, you're not supposed to be awake.
Right.
Because you start to get, well, he started a gag reflex because,
oh yeah,
you know, when it goes down and.
Yeah, they've got you intubated. So. Yeah. We're going to talk about intubation in a little bit, actually.
Great.
Yeah. So on page 435, they're just talking about the incision codes. The lavage of the maxillary sinuses is 31,000. Again, think sinus infection, think getting all of that cleaned out. It's just basically introducing some kind of saline in there to wash out your sinus cavities. A sinusotomy on page 436 is the procedure in which the physician enlarges the passage or creates a new passage from the nasal cavity into the sinus. For whatever reason, the sinus cavity either becomes too narrow or obstructed, and they need to do something to help facilitate the breathing. Okay, now we'll talk about the larynx for a little bit. Enough about the nose. There's a lot of procedures that happen in here, but one of the things that I want to make sure that one of the concepts that I want to make sure that we talk about tonight is this concept of neck dissections and radical neck dissections. So when we talk about the larynx, it's right in through here, okay? And there's a lot of other structures, if you will, important structures that are in here. And so typically, like for 31360, for example, laryngectomy total without radical neck dissection. So basically they're saying in this case, they're just taking out the larynx, okay? They'll reconstruct the airway, or they'll make, put a tracheotomy in there, something for breathing through the larynx. But the radical neck dissection usually has to do with the presence of lymph nodes. Usually these laryngectomies would be performed, like this one may be performed, the 31360 may be performed for injury or something like that. When we, that term radical neck dissection should clue you in, or should be what you're looking for if you have some kind of malignancy or that you're coding for, that the patient has some kind of malignancy that you're coding for. So when they do a radical neck dissection, they're taking out lymph nodes and tissue and muscle and structures. That would be 31365. Okay, we're going to see this term radical dissection repeatedly. Radical neck dissection, we'll talk about it again when we talk about the digestive system and they're removing parts of the esophagus or the tongue.
Means malignancy.
It usually means malignancy. What, just the term radical should clue you in that there's some kind of malignancy going on. Maybe I can't think of the word right now. It's getting implants. Okay, that there's some kind of implants in the surrounding tissue from that native tumor that they're addressing. Okay, now, and I'll get into this a little bit more next week when we actually get to the lymph system. I hope we get to the lymph system next week. It might be 2 weeks from now. Yeah, because we're going to do hearts and vascular. The 30,000 section is a big section. And even though it starts with respiratory, it actually covers. We then go from respiratory to cardiac to cardiovascular, and we end the 30,000s with the lymphatic system. So it might be 3 weeks from now, so I'll just take a moment, ruin the surprise. But with a radical neck dissection, there's actually two different concepts, and I have a feeling that at some point CPT, just like they did with moderate sedation, is going to do a major overhaul, because providers actually, you know, they want to minimize the risks to the patient. So a modified a radical neck dissection, they're not paying attention. They are, but let's just say for all intents purposes, they're just taking everything. If it's a radical neck dissection, they don't care what it is. It's coming out of there, okay? Typically, however, what happens in the practices that I see is they're doing what they call a modified radical dissection. And I think we talked about this a little bit when we talked about breast procedures, mm-hmm. especially in the axillary region. They're coming in, they're taking this one. I don't like the looks of this one. I'm taking this one. I don't like the looks of this one. I'm taking this one. Everything else can stay, which is a benefit to the patient, not to lose muscle and vessel and nerve and lymph and all of those things. Depends on the extent of the disease. But if it's a modified radical dissection, if that's what they've documented, we wouldn't be applying these radical neck dissection codes.
Okay?
We couldn't, because that's not what they're doing. Radical, believe it or not, even though they're taking more, there's more skill into the cherry picking mode. Okay?
Yep.
So just keep that in mind, because this concept comes up a lot. So most of these codes in the larynx section, and that's the point that I'm kind of ad-libbing that they're trying to make in this section on 436, is it's differentiated between whether they're adding that neck dissection as well. Okay. For the larynx, intubation is the establishment of an airway. That's in the introduction codes. You'll notice that there's a modifier 51 exempt code there. Okay. Typically, that wouldn't be done in conjunction with other stuff. Typically, it wouldn't. If they have to establish an airway and do other stuff, typically this is going to be bundled. But let's just say that in an emergency situation, an ED doc, for example, has to establish an airway in an emergent situation and intubate the patient before they can get them stabilized enough to go to the OR.
Isn't that something that an EMT can do as well, like in an ambulance?
Yeah.
That would be that code as well, wouldn't it?
It would, yeah. Okay.
So before surgical procedure?
Usually, yeah. Usually. It would be very rare, and they're just cluing you in here, too, with that modifier 51 exempt. It's usually not something that you'd have in conjunction with other procedures. The other one, the 31502, tracheotomy tube change. So let's say that the patient does have a stoma in their trachea to help facilitate breathing and sometimes language if they have a voice button. Oftentimes when the patient comes back in and they're evaluating the lower part of the respiratory system, because there's a break in the channel, they can come in and evaluate from the top. They get a code for the top up and looking around. So I'm trying to think. It wouldn't be, it would be like a nasoscopy code, a nasal endoscopy code. They could get that one for reviewing the nasal system from the stoma up, and then they go through the stoma to review down. We'll talk about those in just a second. But oftentimes they have to remove that tube in order to get a scope in there. And oftentimes the providers want to report for the change of that tube. That's not what this code is for. This is prior to the establishment of a fistula tract. A fistula tract meaning that it's become incorporated. Okay, but that's not what that code is for. So it's very rarely reported. It really is.
Okay, so this code is or isn't for someone who already has one?
It is for someone who already has one. They're changing one, but tracheotomy tube change prior to the establishment of a fistula tract. Fistula tract meaning that it's started to incorporate in there. The tube is starting to become part of the anatomy.
I was going to say it's starting to be what do you call it, skins growing around it or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
So they have to keep changing them. So
they
that
do.
Won't happen.
Right, yeah.
I know, I worked.
But it's very, like I said, this is a sticking point for a lot of providers. Every time they bring a patient in and scope them through their stoma and change the tube, they want to add that on there.
They can't.
That's
but
not
they
the
can't. That's
no,
not what it is.
That's not the intent of
so
the code.
So what is the code for changing, normally changing that tube out? If they're doing it because of an endoscopy, are they just taking the endoscopy?
It's,
tube?
It's bundled. It's bundled.
So they cannot take an additional code.
Correct.
I
this
see.
Code
oh, yeah.
is the one that's changed so it won't be, the skin won't grow around it to prevent that. That's what this code is for.
It's before that happens, but it would be
right.
for other reasons. Like, let's say the only thing I can... that comes to mind when they could bill that is, let's say that tube has some kind of mechanical complication, it's broken, or it's not functioning properly, then that's something that they'd replace it for. Okay, then you'd report that code. But oftentimes they're taking them in and out so often that it becomes bundled to the procedures that they're doing. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah.
And I worked in a nursing home and they had to clean, we had a woman that had one and they had to clean it, except the nurse pulled it out.
Okay.
But that's something that we need to keep in mind more for if we're dealing with the provider.
Right.
And that provider is, you know, adamant, well, I'm going to bill that. No, you can't do that because.
And in these two. Like when we, okay.
Because
so,
it would be like double billing if you tried to put both of those.
Right. It's the concept is like when we talked about fixation devices,
mm-hmm.
okay? If they have to remove some kind of non-native material in order to approach the service that they need to do, then they can't bill for getting that stuff out of the way so that they can do what they intended to do. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Makes sense, Marty?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes, it does.
All right. Okay. So on page 180,
I'm adamant that
I was going to get there, but I don't know. The trachea and bronchi tubes, so again, we're further down. And usually there's a specific scope for that. That's the other thing. Depending, it doesn't matter what they say they're using for a tool. Again, back to that point that we made before, it depends on what they're reviewing. So they could use a bronchoscope, but only go as far as the trachea. Okay? Even though they've inserted a bronchoscope, if they don't make it to the bronchus, they don't get to have the code for that. Okay, so I want to keep that in mind because they're famous for doing that. So the trachea and bronchi codes, a tracheostomy that's planned. Think a patient that's been in the hospital, usually your CCU critical care. Why can I not think of that? Critical care unit patients. That are need some kind of ventilation or respiration device to keep them going, and they have to put a tracheostomy in for that. That's a planned. When we talked before about intubating is through the mouth, but let's say that they can't because maybe there's some kind of crush injury from a motor vehicle accident, and they need to put one in emergently, put one of these tubes in emergently, that's a different code. So the 31600 is when it's planned. It is also a differentiation between years. Okay, so 31600 is for the general population. There's a 31600 if the patient is younger than 2 years of age. And then there's a three.
It's still planned though, correct?
It's still planned, yes it is. And then there's a 31600 that's an emergency procedure for the transtracheal. or 31605, also emergent, but for the cricothyroid. Now, the difference between these two, they demonstrate and illustrate very well in your textbook on page 438. It's very rare that I've seen them do the cricothyroid membrane approach. It's a little bit higher up. Those two yellow pieces, by the way, they're under there. That's the thyroid. We'll get to that in the 60,000s. But usually your transtracheal approach is a horizontal incision across, whereas when they're doing a cricothyroid, it's a vertical incision that goes along the actual trachea. So that would be your clue on which one you're dealing with. That would be a big clue, okay? Whether it's a horizontal incision or a vertical incision across the...
So which code is which one?
The 31603, and these are both for emergency situations, by the way. If it's planned, it doesn't matter, okay? But if it's emergency, if they're doing a horizontal incision...
That's the
transtracheal. Yep.
Okay.
The 31600. Okay. And if they're doing a vertical incision, it's the cricothyroid membrane approach in order to gain access into that trachea.
What would the reason be for having to do one over the other?
Just
in a different spot?
Yeah.
Or whatever?
Yeah. Yeah. But that cricothyroid membrane, from what I understand, is a little bit more extensive.
Okay.
A little bit more technically difficult. It's probably the better word for it. Okay. When we start looking at the endoscopy codes, you're going to see... okay, I'm going to back up for just a second. That voice button that I was talking about before... Okay, if they're doing the, they need to put a voice prosthesis in there, that's that 31611. Okay, that's where that code is.
So, the fistula?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. And then if they're revising the stoma, okay, this has nothing to do with the tube. This has to do with the physical anatomic opening itself. If they have to... change it in some way, maybe move it up or down or widen it or something like that. Those revision codes are what we're looking for there. The 31613, the 31614, and it all depends on if they have to rotate skin and tissue in order to make that revision happen.
So, like, you'd say, like, changing the opening?
Yes. Yep. Yep. That's exactly what that is. And I'm not going to do it. I won't go there because these are a lot. All right. So once again, I did not make it through the entire chapter. We came very close.
Only a couple pages.
Yeah, only a couple. But these are pretty big concepts, so I don't want to shortchange and try and rush through it in 2 minutes. There's a lot here, and you'll notice, again, lots of triangles. There were big revisions here, but... basically, I just want to make sure that as we start getting into the trachea and bronchus and into the lungs, that I make sure I do that adequately. So I'll save that for next time. And again, so the plan will be to finish chapter 16. Let me move my thing. Chapter 16. I'll go back and do chapter 9 with the HCPCS, and then we'll proceed. And chances are, once again, we won't get through all of it, but my goal is going to be to complete chapter 17. But there's a lot. Cardiovascular, there's a lot there, okay? Because we've got different approaches and just dealing with the heart and the veins. We'll have a lot, okay? All right. Any questions, concerns?
No.
Nope. I wanted you to take a look at your NEVA section because I think I solved the problem. I think they didn't put NEVAs. I found the one that had it. It was chapter 14, the chapter review, number 23.
Okay.
It was removal of 180 centimeters square and strawberry nevus of the left cheek. Autograph with split thickness, skin graft of 180 centimeters. And I was having trouble finding nevus. But the answer is actually this one, Q82.5. So then I started looking at the ones that we had done in there, and I marked, so like this one, So face specified was D2239.
Oh.
Forehead was D2239, which would match up with that. Nose, so they external, have it as a
different
D2239.
Because right there.
Because it says nevus.
Okay.
D22.9.
Marty, did you hear that?
Yeah, I'm listening.
Yeah, Kim solved the mystery. So we didn't look over far enough in the index of your ICD-10 book.
And it's almost like it should be one down. It should hit enter.
Yeah.
They didn't hit enter. So where it says nevocarcinoma, C melanoma, they should have hit enter and they didn't because the word nevus is there.
Oh.
It's there, and then all the subsequent codes that go with it. But the way it looks like all of these are entries to nevocarcinoma.
But they're not.
Good job. Thank you. Because that just didn't make sense. Why they would leave a whole section out? But it's
I'll be a coder yet.
it's a typo. Excellent. Okay. Excellent. All right. Yeah, mystery solved.
Well, at least now I know where to find nevus. That was driving me bananas. Oh my gosh, Marty, it was nuts.
All right, well, thank you very much. And if there's any questions or anything that come up, please feel free to email.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.